our first session on the state authorization track. We have Brianna L that's going to be discussing distance education and state authorization. Brianna is a graduate of the College of Engineering in Newburgh, Virginia. After graduation, she secured employment at Accreditation Coordinator and account specialist with the Distance Education and Training Council, which is a national accreditation body located in Washington, D.C. In October 2013, New York University recruited Brianna to serve as Accreditation Coordinator in the Office of the Assistant Provost. As Accreditation Coordinator, Brianna works to spearhead all state authorization efforts, which is a huge job. Working on that on the state authorization efforts and aims of Middle State Commission on Higher Education site visit preparation tasking. She has created and implemented several organizational systems that serve to both efficiently and effectively manage the institution's vast activity levels in relation to compliance standards. Brianna attends New York University, where she is pursuing an MBA in public and nonprofit management and policy within the international policy specialization. Thank you for being here, and Brianna.
We only offer 2 degrees online, or we to distance education. It's also related to the brick and mortar campus offerings. So didn't this issue go away? Then some things popped up in the news that said, oh, this doesn't apply anymore, the federal courts vacated this decision. I don't have to worry about it anymore. I saw a headline that said it went away. It didn't. The federal regulation was vacated by court order in 2012, but the regulation was set aside purely on procedural grounds. So even without federal regulations, the individual states are still enforcing their laws and we still do need to comply with them. So we wish it went away, but it didn't. So today, I'm going to talk about some of the triggers for physical presence. Individual states will say, if you do this or you do that, we feel that you're physically present within our state, and therefore I'm going to regulate you and you need to register or authorize in our state. And it used to be you just had a building there, and that was physical presence, and now it's much more complex. And then I'm going to talk about the process within and what we do to navigate compliance in such a complex structure. How to identify your institutional activity. I think one thing that isn't talked about much in the public forum is the cost of state authorization. It's very intimidating, it's incredibly complex. I'm gonna share with you how we calculated the cost and did a presentation to get appropriate budget allocations and different ways that people are dividing that to make it financially feasible to comply. Then implementing a strategic plan and what are other institutions doing that is very helpful. So, well, the first thing I want to talk about are the individual triggers that states feel determine a physical presence. So we have marketing or advertising. Some states feel that if you market or advertise at all to their state residents, if you put a billboard up in their state, I don't know if anybody read that article about Barry University in Tennessee, they say, hey, we want to regulate that, but when I see it first, it's going to our consumers, you should have authorized. Some states regulate on a trigger of distance education faculty. If you're a distance education school located in New York and you employ a faculty member who's living in Georgia while they're delivering education to your students, depending on the circumstances surrounding the delivery and the employment, they may say, hey, we want to regulate you, that person's paying taxes in our state and living here and delivering information to residents everywhere, and we need you to register. Proctoring, bond rate. This is something that a very small number of states regulate on, but it's still present. They say it's not just do you proctor or don't you proctor, because that would be too easy. It's how do you proctor. Is it virtual proctoring? Is it face-to-face proctoring? Is there a learning center that a student is going to? Is it group proctoring? Is it individual? So there are a lot of nuances within these. Some say, do you offer distance education in general? Are you enrolling a student from Mississippi or Minnesota in Air Force that is coming to the server in New York? If so, send me your paperwork and send me a check. And then the biggest one for New York University and potentially a lot of you in this room is non-classroom experiences. It's probably the most complicated to navigate, but it's also probably the most important because this encompasses internships, externships, student teaching, clinicals, practicums, clerkships, anything where one of your students is physically going to another state for that learning experience. And I think the culture of education has trended towards encouraging that. You want your students to go out and get real life experience. Employers want to see that, to see value. And we've been promoting it, providing these opportunities, and spending a lot of time and money to put together contracts to make these opportunities available to our students. And in order for them to legally be able to go, in a lot of states, there's a lot of red tape that you need to navigate first. So I just depict the most complex and kind of give you a visual image of how complex it can be to navigate. I'm gonna just pull out non-classroom experience. This is small on purpose so you don't get distracted with the detail, but basically it's very hard to even come up with categories to give programs within your school guidance on what they can and can't do. So this is just one page of, I think, a four-page report, and green is okay, you can go there. Purple is you might be able to go there, but read this nuance further. For example, Florida says, okay, you can go there, but if it's a medical clerkship, you need to register there. So this is just a resource that I provided, and I also provided a map for my individual schools and programs within my school to help them navigate the activity that is and is not okay as we work towards complete compliance and trying to go back to opening all of these opportunities to all of our students and not restricting. But basically what you get is just one giant mess. On what activity is happening. In general, educational institutions tend to be managed in a decentralized structure. all struggle to navigate. Originally, I think they thought, okay, we can build distance education over here, we can offer occupational therapy here, we can have med school here, and nobody really needs to talk to each other, and that's okay. But for this issue, everybody needs to talk to each other. It's not enough to just go to your distance ed coordinator and say, do you have placements, yes or no, I'm done. Because all of these other schools within your college are creating opportunities for their students, and you need to be in touch with all of them if you're the one coordinating state authorization within your school. So the issues that arise are just that you have to talk to everybody, how many people are there, did you identify everybody, because so-and-so said to talk to Jim, but then you found out that Sally was doing it too. So there's always this issue, and the way that NYU navigated it was to come up with a comprehensive survey. And we really sat down at the provost level and made a list not only of every individual school, but the centers or organizations that also have offerings to our students. So we have a Wasserman Ridge Career Center that makes placements available to our students that sometimes works with individual schools or programs. So the schools and programs may not be tracking that, where the students are going, they're saying, well, Wasserman set them up. So you don't want to miss any gaps of information, you want to have a comprehensive summary. And then within that, once creating the survey became a difficult task, because you made 5 questions, you thought, okay, I have it all. And then you realize, because of the nuances within each standard that could be a trigger for physical presence within the state, that it wasn't enough to say, do you have a non-classroom experience that's required or optional for your student? Because within being required or optional, some states say we only regulate if it's for credit, or we only regulate if it's not for credit, if it leads to licensure, if the student is paid or unpaid, if the person supervising the placement physically in the state is an employee of your university versus an employee of just the organization that the student is completing the experience at. So the survey became, I think, 3 or 4 pages. And if you had limited activity in your school, it could take 2 minutes to complete. If you had extensive activity, it could take 40 minutes to complete, because you click one and you get 5 more, because we really needed to know everything. So once we came up with this, we surveyed all of our programs, we talked to them and answered any questions that they had about the nuances. And then it's really important, regardless of your size, whether you're 1,000 students or 10,000 students, there's no way that anybody has the staff to manage reentry of data. And it needs to be a system that's sustainable, where you can aggregate data with the click of as small number of buttons as possible. So something that you can distribute annually that aggregates into one database that you can run into an Excel report and just do minimal cleaning of data to manage is really ideal. And for this, NYU used a system called Qualtrics. It's slightly more advanced than SurveyMonkey, but it allows you to build matrix questions and all different kinds of forms, and that was really helpful for us. So survey results, you get all this data and you clean it up, it looks really pretty in a spreadsheet, what do you do with it? Summarizing it in a user-friendly form, because you're going to have to share it with a lot of institutional staff to make them understand what you need for budget allocations, what do you need, who do you need to hop on board to make this process happen successfully. And then there could be individual departments that are going to say, why did you ask me that? Why does that matter? I've done that for 20 years. You can't tell me now that I can't send a student to North Carolina. Somebody was there last semester. Who are you to come in and say this? So, there's a lot of pushback, you know, when you come in and say, sorry, you can't do that anymore. You're all of a sudden the enemy. But I find it really helpful when I go into those situations to remind them, I work for NYU too. I'm on your side. I want all of these opportunities to be available to your students, and I'm going to do everything possible to make them available. There have been a lot of states that I've been able to get one-time exemptions in. If I have one student going someplace and our school's already promised them they could go there, instead of just saying you need to go back and tell your student, it's worth the moment with the state regulators to say, this is the situation, we are going to authorize in your state, we're not ready to embark on it yet, we're still gathering all the data necessary, can we have a one-time exemption for this student? And a lot of times the state regulators, are just so pleased that you come to them and that you've said, you know, help me, I'm here, I'm ready, I'm going to authorize, that they'll work with you. So that will help you and your school always offer help. You're there as a resource, and when necessary, feel free to pull on either in-house legal counsel or out-of-house legal counsel to let them know, hey, this is the law. This isn't something that I'm arbitrarily enforcing. This is a legal issue with financial ramifications for non-compliance, risk management issues where your student may get to the end and go to get licensure and be turned down because your school didn't do the paperwork. So legal kind of gives you a lot of clout there. And one firm that we've been working with that absolutely adore is ADEIL Conference. They're amazing in this field. They know it inside and out. They work with a lot of schools. And you can get them on the phone and come for the most obscure question where you think, yeah, I can spend all day trying to find this and call 50 of my friends in the industry and not get the answer. And they answer in 2 seconds. They're just downloaders. And they're in Washington, D.C. And they're really, really amazing. So how much does this cost? Everyone can throw it out figures. And when I first started driving, gas was 89 cents a gallon. Right? And what are we up to now? Like $4.50, $4.60? It just keeps going up. So I feel like the gas trends are similar to the state authorization trends. So in order to get a hold of the fee structure, I entered everything into SPSS, which is a statistical database that has a lot of power and is really helpful. I went through state by state, and I determined different categories. So there are different fee structures within how states bill, for lack of a better word, for this process. And 41% of the states have a variable fee structure, and 59% of the states have a fixed fee structure. With a fixed region, anywhere from $0, where you just submit a form and there's no money exchange, to about $4,000. And then some states have a startup fee, a one-time fee to process the initial paperwork. Some states have a one-time site visit, programmatic reviews. And within this spectrum, 40% do not have a startup fee, and 60% do, with the startup fees ranging anywhere from $100 to $10,000. And then within the upper and lower limits, the 79% had an upper limit listed between $2,500 and $25,000, and 23% of states had a lower limit of $100 to $2,500. So first I tried to get a feel of how are they going, do they cap it, is there an absolute maximum or minimum? And then I took my results for my student, for my surveys, my individual schools with the actual activity and tried to estimate a number of NYU enrollments, because some are enrollment based, of NYU programs. How many degrees do we have that trigger the activity in the states that bill by degree or by program? And then I created an individual formula for the institutional total cost, which was all of the fixed and all of the variable estimates totaled together. And the way that I got that was by creating a line item formula for each state individually. So just to kind of show you how to get to this, and I'm happy to talk more offline about details of maybe more complicated states, but Idaho is a state, for example, that has an enrollment-based fee structure. And it could range from $100 to $5,000. And the formula that they ask you to use to compute their fees is 1/2 of 1% of the gross annual tuition from Idaho enrollments. So I ran enrollments that we had last year from Idaho to get an estimate and looked at the last 3 years to see if they were trending up or down, and kind of just plugged and chugged, and I knew there would never be less than 100 and there would be more than 5,000, so if my enrollments put me over 5,000, I capped it out for the purpose of getting the total and just ran the numbers like that. A more complex cost structure is Maryland. I think we all heard so much about Maryland. Maryland was one of the first states to institute a hard deadline for when you needed to file paperwork, and they were one of the first states to be very public about the fact that if you were not compliant, you were facing a $20,000 fine in their state. So Maryland has two processes. One is registration and one is authorization. Incredibly different. Authorization is very complex. Registration is very simple comparatively. Registration has an annual fee of $1,000, and it gives you an okay to enroll their students for distance education purposes. And we've done that. The next step is authorization, which gives you the permission for the more complicated issue of sending your students to do non-classroom experiences in their state. Maryland is similar to North Carolina in that it's an educational rich state where students are going to want to go close to DC, which is a hub that has a lot of hospitals, that has a lot of great university structures that are very vast with their offerings, and students are going to be really attracted to this state, so it is a high priority, I think, for a lot of our institutions. So the fee structure then becomes based on the number of programs, and it fluctuates depending on the number of years that you're authorized. So they charge 5 programs, and then every year for the first 5 years, and then it goes to a rolling fee structure once every 5 years, once you've been compliant for 5 years straight. So it's very complicated, and it could really fluctuate thousands and thousands of dollars depending on how many programs you're putting through or how many students you're enrolling. So once you can kind of get a hold of the cost structure and you go and you figure out where the money's going to come from, it might be a very large figure for NYU. The range came up to be somewhere between $300,000 and $500,000. have 830 programmatic offerings. So it might be somewhere between 40,000 for smaller institutions. And even with that number, it's easy to get scared and scare those of you that you're asking for the funds. But a lot of schools have taken the approach of breaking it up into phases. It's not like you have to write a check for $350,000 in 1 month or 1 year. You don't have the time to do the paperwork for all of the states in 1 year. So you don't need all that money in 1 year. So you can say, you know, phase one, in the first 6 months, I'm going to comply in 6 of these states. And this is a realistic goal. This is how long the process takes in these states. I need $20,000. And this is why. And it might be in next year's budget. And you might just kind of plan if you've got on the horizon. But it is something that, again, is a law, does need to happen. Budget allocations are going to have to be made from somewhere. And now you're at the point of, we're ready to apply, what do I need? So states are very different, every state requires something different, but these are some of the key things that most of the states will ask for. They're going to want enrollment numbers, they're going to want proof of institutional and specialized accreditation, a summary of your activity level, a sample or summary of the advertisements that are being put out by your university, a list of courses. Sometimes they're even asking for professors' individual CVs. So if you don't currently keep them in file, it might be wise to look into a system of maintaining them somewhere centralized. A list of the CVs. They are also looking at your refund policy and your complaint procedure. And with these two items, they're often asking you to alter it, which can be complicated and sensitive. Sometimes it's a very reasonable structure, and you just have to put a disclaimer on your website to say if you're from Maryland, you have the right to file your complaint here with the State Department of Education in Maryland, and you just have to add one line item to your website. Sometimes it's onerous, and you have to really sit down and run the math with a CFO or someone who calculates it and make a separate table available to residents from specific states for their refund structure. What are other institutions doing? I've had a lot, we were just talking about this in the beginning, a lot of programs feel infringed upon, and they say, we've always been doing this, none of our colleagues are doing this, the school up the road is not restricting. I just got an email yesterday from one of my departments that said, I talked to Lady at Columbia, and they're not restricting at all, why are you restricting me from this? So again, a reminder, it's not me, it's the law. So larger institutions, and larger institutions of more than 20,000 students, 41%, respondents to the survey plan to apply for authorization in every single state. And the details of the survey are below in black. It was Sloan Seed and the Cheese supported survey that was done last year. The percentage of schools that have not applied to any states, this is a really key number to me personally because it shows the trend of people hopping on board and really that the buy-in is happening, the realization that it's happening is there. In 2011, there were 67% of schools that had not applied to one single state. And in 2012, that number dropped to 37%. So a lot of schools really either brought people on staff to do it or assigned it to some people who already had been on staff and had a task force already. And the trend is definitely that everybody's really applying and doing the paperwork and figuring it out. 10% of schools indicated that they expected to turn away no students. I think that that's probably the larger schools where it's really not feasible to turn away students and where the funds are more readily available to make that possible. 72% of schools are restricting enrollments and placements. That's a really big number. So that means that at least in one state they're saying, as a business decision, that's not worth it for us. You know, this state is $50,000. We have 3 students enrolled from there. We are so sorry, but right now it just doesn't make sense. And that's okay. It's okay to say that. Schools are saying that. They're putting statements on their website that say we are not currently enrolling residents from Arkansas or you know, whatever state, respectively. So of those 72%, 20% said that they were likely to turn away more than 100 students, with some turning away thousands. So it's just the reality of the situation. You can do what you can, and you can't do what you can't do. Is there any hope? Reciprocity. Everybody says, why can't there just be one common application? Why can't I write one check? Small fee, and I'm accredited, I've proven myself, and accreditation is so onerous, and what's going on? So there is a reciprocity agreement in the works. It's called the SARA agreement, the State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement. I think everyone here has probably seen that somewhere in the news or in a conference independent. It's a model compact, and the regional compacts form the base for it. Unfortunately, New York is not part of any regional compact, so the SARA agreement went into effect tomorrow. It would not impact my institution, buy into this concept of the regional agreement and sign on, at which point then it would impact us. So I don't know if anybody else is in that situation. But even so, regardless, at this point there has been a large grant from the Lumina Foundation for I think $3 million to fund this initiative. And they have actually brought staff on already that are representatives that are going out to the individual states and saying, these are the terms of the regional compact. We know you've turned it away before, didn't get comfortable signing on. Let's look at the reasons. Let's see how we can edit this so that you do feel comfortable, because we need to give the institutions a break. They don't have the manpower, they don't have the funds, and something has got to give. So they're really, the funds are there to try to achieve this goal. The staff is now in place, and they have started going out there and having those conversations. I think that we're probably at least 3 years away from this really coming together. And then the question is, in what form and how many states? It could be 3 years. We might see 10 states sign on because of the diversity in the application process. I think it's Wyoming that has kind of a one-page form about your institution with $50 fee. But then you have states like Maryland or Massachusetts, God forbid,
yes.
who it could cost you hundreds of thousands of dollars in that one state if you don't want to restrict anyone. And it's very unclear what the process is. Nothing is published. To share my experience, Massachusetts is very close to New York. And we have a lot of activity there. And we have a want and a need to continue that activity there for our students. So that's one of the states that was very high on my priority list. And I draft a letter with legal counsel to notify them of our activity. And I work with Dublin, so we expected to get back a letter saying, yay or nay, you're okay, thanks for the letter. You're not okay, here's all the paperwork and here's the fee. Instead, we got back a survey online where you click a link and it says, tell us a little more. So they want more information from me before I can have more information from them about what the process entails. And you can only see the first two questions of the survey when you click the link, so you're not really sure what's ahead. And North Carolina is very similar. North Carolina is a very expensive state. They actually require a full site visit, just like your regional accreditors do, and programmatic reviews by subject specialists, just like regional accreditation. So it's probably going to be about $20,000 anyway to turn it, depending on the number of degree offerings. And they have 15 standards that they ask for you to comply with. You don't get access to the 15 standards until you give them a letter saying you plan to go through licensure with them and physically go visit their campus in Chapel Hill to have a meeting to let them know that you're authorizing, and that's when they hand over the 15 standards to you, where you can then see what you need to comply with. So it is scary, it is kind of, there's an unknown abyss to some of the states. It's kind of intimidating.
I hate to interrupt you, but I was just gonna make a comment about the North Carolina visit. We actually went to North Carolina and did that site visit. Because we do have quite a few students that do internships in North Carolina. And I didn't find it as bad as what I thought it was gonna be, and as bad as it, seemed to be. Once we got there and explained what we were doing, we don't even think it's okay to seek authorization. So,
congratulations.
I would just say, even though they seem very intimidating, once you can afford the plane trip there, it may not be as bad as what you're thinking. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know if they try to scare people off from coming there. Or,
are you a SATS member?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
Yeah.
your offerings, and I just find that I learn more from my colleagues when I do from reading. I know this little group right here, when I hear what we know about, I'm probably really happy to include you guys on it, where when something happens, if it didn't come up on my radar, it came up on theirs, and we share it. So that's been really beneficial for us. And just being able to pick up the phone and say, what did you do, or did you do this date, and just helping each other. You know, some, I might have spent hours reading North Carolina, I could tell you in 2 minutes, but you could spend 3 days reading, and just not being afraid to call each other and help each other through the process. So my contact information is there, and I have cards, I'm happy to give them, and I'm always available. And I sincerely need that. Please pick up the phone and talk. That's it. You guys have a great time. Triggers for these big money states that are in the whole insurance processes. So at that point, the only thing that I can think is that it becomes a consumer protection issue. And that it's just another protection from liability that, you know what, we know that your vendor did their due diligence, and we know that your programmatic developer and the CCNE firm did their due diligence. But before you came into our state, we also checked you off. And this is what we did. We checked all of their work. So that is, I think, part of the biggest basis and driving force behind the reciprocity request, is that how many times can you check the same thing? And how many times can you give me a different form where I fill out the same information, whether it's number one or number three? Why can't you have any kind of faith in this system and just realize that the items and standards do match up almost point for point, and have some kind of like breather for me so that I don't want to crazy filing here and filing there. And that's the bottom line. The states are historically underfunded, right? And they need some kind of revenue to be able to support this, and it makes extra more work for them than they didn't have before. So sometimes they've had to hire people, sometimes they've had to give hour and day increases to people already on the books. And I think that that's a, for some states, that is a big part of it. Unfortunately.
When you were gathering all your data to figure out what the cost was going to be, what did you use to determine a return on investment?
That's a good question.
You know, we had a brief informal conversation before that, but now that you formalized it, how did you demonstrate to the folks who are going to give you money?
It was the provost. Originally, when I first came on staff, they kind of knew, Dowler was suggested that they hire someone, NYU hire someone for the position, and that because of the size of NYU, they not add the task pre-existing, but create a separate position within the office of the provost to navigate it. So they did that, and that's where I came on. And then they said, you know, what we'd really like to do is figure out how to parse out these fees, because it's not fair that, you know, one school pays all the fees and another school benefits, because with the decentralized structure that I'm sure many of you experience, each school has a different budget. And if a student takes a course from a different school, the fees they pay for that, then that school not going to enroll in. So it's not a lateral system. It's not a linear system for where the money goes within one institution, like someone who's not familiar with the budget issues of an institution may think. So then, originally they tasked me with saying, figure out how to say what percentage nursing should pay for Massachusetts, and what percentage dental should pay in Massachusetts, relative to how many places they have going there. So when I got into the complexities of how the fees are structured and the fluctuation in the fact that we may send 5 students this year from our teaching program for student teachers to North Carolina, and we may send 0 next year, and you can employ 5 people full-time on payroll to manage how you're going to bill
the individual schools, and you can exhaust all of those resources if that's what you really want to do, and you want to hold them accountable per penny on the value that that individual school is getting from the placements they're able to do. Or we can come together and realize we're all working for the same mission to better the educational opportunities for our students and to open all of the doors we can. And we can do a line item budget allocation from the top down. So that's what, after I showed them the complexities of how the state's built, I ended my presentation and said, so would you like me to take another 9 months to figure out how to build the individual schools? And at that point, they kind of said, you know what, it doesn't make sense to waste the staff resources financially or, you know, just the time to figure that out. So we did a line item budget from the provost office. And I think that really impacted the buy-in, because before it was up to the individual schools, if this costs us money, we might need to restrict where our students can go. And it pains us to have to restrict it and tell students no, and decreases the value of your program, because when they sign on, at that point you have to have a disclaimer that says, thanks for being part of our dental school. Unfortunately, you can't complete your clerkship in the following 20 states. And then, you know, what does that say about the value of your program and the openness of what you can offer them? So in terms of ROI, I didn't run a formula number, because the message and feedback that I was getting from the impact that it would have on the individual schools for not being able to offer it was such a strong message, just from outsider looking in, restrictive, making opportunities available. I think that I had a little more momentum behind me too, because MOU is embarking on this global network. I don't know if you guys have read about it, but we opened a campus in Shanghai in September, and we have a campus in Abu Dhabi, and we don't say it because it's some other countries, and our whole theory is this open door policy. We want you to go everywhere and experience everything to the fullest extent. So for the mission statement and the direction that our institution was going in and wanting to trend towards, ROI aside, restriction doesn't match with the goal. So that's kind of how I presented it, but I did not run a formula base number. Yeah, it would be very interesting. I should probably, just out of personal curiosity, see what that number would look like. Yeah. Back here. Okay. Sure.
Yes, just one more. Anybody with athletics recruiting, how do you have to go approach this?
With athletics?
In terms of state presence, but presence.
Some states with recruiting, because that's one of the triggers.
Kansas, it would be.
Yeah. And so some states require that you may have to have licensed agents. Mm-hmm. So you have to pay a fee to have an agent license to be an advisor or a coach that's going within that state to recruit. So then it may cost $50, $100, or something along those lines. It gets into some of the marketing if you're doing direct recruiting versus or targeted or you know, blind recruiting and items like that. So there are some states that have to deal with them. Now I'm working with three or four. Our institution doesn't have athletics. I'm so thankful. But I'm working with several other institutions that they run into this, and it's with the advising model and their advising and recruiting efforts to where it impacts that.
Well, I mean, athletic recruiting is so much more complicated because it involves all the NCAA roles, and I think athletics traditionally has viewed itself as completely outside of any regulation because they are so heavily regulated by the NCAA.
Yeah.
And so it is very difficult to, once you've targeted those states that isolate based on recruitment, mm-hmm. to match those NCAA rules with those state rules. Because we compete in football, but we have a highly competitive division. We're at the top of our division. So we feel like we have a highly competitive, for our division of athletes, recruiting process. Mm-hmm. And athletics is very much not interested in participating in anything that recruits their access to athletes. Mm-hmm. Our athletics will go so far as to specifically figure out how to exactly work at the very edge of the rule.
Yeah.
Like, okay, I can talk to this student when the student is physically present at a game in another state, right? Which you can do, mm-hmm. not a violation of the rules. And so they're looking to try to figure out how to work at the very edge of the rules, because the idea that you would restrict athletic recruitment at a new school where athletics runs a whole lot of stuff, you just don't a massive fact.
We have a very similar issue that Patty has. My office does oversee the NCAA compliance as well, with house, not me personally, but within my office, one of my colleagues who works in the next office over, oversees that, and the provost that I report to is who she also reports to, so ultimately we're overseen by the same compliance structure for management purposes, and we have the same situation where they're just on the outer edge. They're always finding a loophole, and sometimes there are loopholes, and sometimes you really can and should use them to your advantage. One of my schools have placed a student in North Carolina, they run a military base, and the state can't regulate that land.
Right.
So my student was living and working on a military base for their placement, and they were impervious to the regulation. So I notified them because it's happening in their state, just to let them know, but I did not use that as a trigger. But for our athletes, if there is a big pushback, I've experienced the same thing that Patty has from athletic recruiters. They do tend to feel that they're in a different area, it doesn't apply to them, they have their own compliance rules, they don't need more, they don't want restrictions, it is a big revenue generator. And I actually met with the offices separately just because I did my individual school. And I had them fill out the same survey that my schools filled out. And I said, I need to know more about your marketing and advertising and recruiting habits. And, you know, do you hire recruiters so that, you know, Bob is employed and Bob does for Georgia and Alabama? And Sally does New York, Massachusetts, New Hampshire. What is the structure here? Tell me more about it, and then I'll come up with some kind of system so that we can be in compliance across the board. And I have gone through and registered some of my agents in specific states like Florida. I'm actually finishing the paperwork right now. They run a background check. It costs $50. It's a one-time fee, and then an annual $200 fee per recruiter. And I'm filling out their birthday, their date of initial employment with us, and whether you're going to Florida once to recruit at a formal event, or you're going to Florida every month or every week, or somebody's living in Florida recruiting for you, that $200 fee will be annual for that individual. The $50 background check will be one time. And whether it's for athletics or for general college fairs or graduate school fairs, that recruiter needs to be registered if they're on the ground in Florida talking to people.
We have talked about doing in registration and doing like athletics. We talked about doing a pairing where they send a registered recruiter, and then the athletics person travels with the registered recruiter. But the registered recruiter is the one who actually, you know, says the words. There's very specific language that you can say to someone in some states, and language you can't in others. And that recruiter would use that language, but the other person would be assessing that person's actual athletic ability.
Yeah.
And then feeding that information to the license or the registered recruiter.
Has anybody challenged any of this on inter and intrastate contact? Has anybody filed a lawsuit?
Maine and state.
Maine?
Yeah. Maine stated that they felt it was unconstitutional to regulate at this level.
But they're the only ones. But the only thing that's ever been begun to challenge is the Berry lawsuit, and it ended up being dropped.
Yeah.
And they were challenging on interstate commerce, which the whole reason that we don't have an interstate commerce lawsuit right now is that a state is the only thing that has the grounds to sue based on interstate commerce, and no individual state has chosen to take on that lawsuit on behalf of their institution. So if it happens, it would most likely be on behalf of the public institution of a state, because otherwise, why would a state choose to sue?
So the institution can't.
Institutions have no standing to sue under interstate commerce. A state would have to sue another state. And at this point, the state said, we're not interested in doing that, and I don't foresee a likelihood that they will become interested.
And they would have to sue every state individually, right?
Well, they would have to, like the Berry lawsuit, you'd have to sue a specific other state, right, about their law being unconstitutional. So yeah, if a state got in that game, and really why would you, it's an incredibly expensive game, you would eventually have to sue all of the other states. Or you'd have to get a district judgment that would say, this is the constitutional interpretation of that. But even if that happened, it would end up in the Supreme Court, which means we would be 15 years away from an actual.
You know, what Brianna brought up earlier about student
That's the state lobbyists up there trying to get them to change the law. But that has to be their home state, their designated, regardless of their location, go back to their home state.
No,
it's where they're physically present, where they're serving, if you have a military student.
But not residency.
That also applies to Native American lands, if you happen to live in a state or a region where, yeah, if you live in a region in the West where there's a lot of Native American lands, then that's a completely separate issue.
But your institution would have to, if the rules go through, and they're being discussed now, if they go through with the DOD, in order for your institution to have students to participate in those, GIDL and all that stuff, you would have to demonstrate that you have sought and received state authorization where you have students stationed at bases who are enrolled in your institution.
And they've actually been enforcing that with specifically contracted institutions, because we are specifically contracted with them, because we are right next to Fort Carson. That's why we even got in this game at all. We were abstaining until 2011 when they said, you will now comply with this or you will lose your federal contract, military contract. And that's the only reason we got in the game to begin with.
And now HLC, I don't know if they're here, but they have